Hello and welcome to the circus. Let's party every day, like there's no other way. Get drunk and play an
extra show. We'll stay out every night and count the city lights till we go. There's no other way, cause it's all I know. Cause it's all I know.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children of all ages, this is Wildcard Wednesdays. This is a special edition of the Fantasy Football Joker, where we sit down once a week with a fantasy football content creator to ask them about them and their lives and so much more. Before we begin, please go join our community and become a content creator yourself, or if you're just looking to interact with some experts, maybe a joker or two, go sign up to fantasyfootballadviceforum.com. You can use my promo code JOKER420. Right now it's actually 20% off. You can get access to exclusive content like my articles, content from all kinds of great creators. There's like medical stuff coming out now. There's all kinds of juicy stuff over there. So make sure you go sign up. And as always, make sure that you like, subscribe, and comment, share the video. Today, I'm super excited about our guest. We are going in raw.
Had your kids, had your wife.
Break yourself, fool!
You know, I had to go with the RVD 420 entrance from the Fantasy Football Hustler. Welcome to the show.
There we go. I like it. And I like the Antoine Dotson. That's a big part of our show as well.
Yeah, that was a nice little drop that I slid in there. I follow your show a lot. I'm a big fan, actually. So it's really cool just to have you on the show from that perspective. Before we get into like that side of it, just the basics, like how'd you start even like playing fantasy football?
So it is a long time ago where I got introduced to fantasy football by someone random. I mean, it's really crazy how it worked out for me because I got in trouble. This is back when I was just the 420 hustler. I got in trouble. Jesus, of course. All right, I got in. All right, here we go. Take two. I got in trouble and got arrested on the Super Bowl game of Pittsburgh and the Seattle Seahawks, and got arrested again in the Steelers game to start that season. And so it was crazy. And then I start working this random job, and some random dude that I can't even really remember his name or anything introduces me to fantasy football. These guys were such degenerates that they drafted after the league had actually, like, after the season already started. Like, this is like a week one, like, draft because everyone's so addicted to it. And that was 2006. I've been playing ever since.
Man. 1 year earlier, I might have seen you get arrested if you had been at the Tennessee Titans Pittsburgh Steelers home opener in 2005. Because, like, you know, I'm from Canada and I live in Quebec. So it's like, we don't travel down there too often for games. But that's one of the few times that I went. So weird how, like, we could have almost crossed paths, except I would have been like a 15-year-old fresh-faced kid. I didn't even smoke weed back then. I was the captain of the high school football team and nobody gave a shit because it was in Northern Ontario where, like, it's like I always joke, there's no bands, there's no fans, there's no cheerleaders, nobody giving a fuck.
I love it.
So, like, what got you into, like, the content creation side once you finished that bong toke?
So, a lot of it is me just finally, like, learning about podcasts, and I was never really a big, like watching YouTube because I was working so much. Like, I would listen to podcasts is what I would do, and I'm just – all these guys, I mean, you know, they're some of the biggest guys in the industry, you know, but, like, it's boring to me. Like, they weren't doing super flex. They're not doing IDP content. You know, I think we're just from, like, different walks of life. And so, like, it wasn't really entertaining, you know, for me a lot of times. And so I always wanted to get into it. And right before COVID happened, I actually went back to college so I could take a video editing course, because I felt like if I could edit some of my own shit, I could just produce my own shit, and then I wouldn't have to rely on anybody. And then COVID comes, whole bunch of stuff happens with a job, and I'd start learning things on the fly. We learn about StreamYard, we just start streaming, and that kind of started it all. Really, COVID gave me the hard push into it.
So, it's funny because COVID obviously affected like people so negatively in so many ways. And it's like, knock on wood, I've been like super lucky in a lot of ways. It like pushed me into doing things that I otherwise wouldn't have done. Like, I test video games now as my regular job, and then I get to do this on the side. So it's like, now I'm just like set up. Whereas before, I was working shitty sales jobs where I'm like having to eat shit, talk to customers, and I was just like, this is the fucking worst. So for you, this is like, this very much like manifest destiny where you're trying to turn it into like now a career, or is it just like you fell ass backwards into it because of everything that happened and now you're having fun with it and what comes of it comes of it?
So ever since COVID, I have not worked a regular job. Like, after that, I've been living off the land, so to speak, as far as like all of this content stuff. Like, in that 2020 year, I was live streaming so much, like 4 hours a day, 4 hours like a stream multiple times a day, just trying to get as many people in front of as many people as I could. And I found a lot of like diehard supporters who were kind of looking for someone who was like 420 friendly and who loved fantasy football, because there's really like not too many of us, out there. And it's been like a super blessing, like this week we're actually, it's a big culmination of the last 3 years. I'm hosting a big event here in Vegas where people are flying in from all over the country, coming to the 420 crew mansion for a big like 420 fantasy football draft extravaganza.
Man, that sounds fucking dope. Like, that's the kind of stuff where it's like, even like the expo this year, like I had to miss it. And it's like, going to America for me is such a chore, sadly. So it's like, I don't always get to do cool shit like that. And I get, you guys are the jelly, or you guys are the peanut butter, and I'm the fucking jelly up here in my frozen rock. But we'll dip into some of the silly shit. I got some of these hypotheticals set up for you. I can't take ownership. These are from one of my favorite authors. His name's Chuck Klosterman. He writes Sex, Drugs, and Cocoa Puffs. So shout out to that. These are like almost like cards of humanity in a sense. But they're like these crazy hypothetical questions.
Okay.
That I really fucking love. So the first one, we'll just dip in. Easy peasy. You have a brain tumor.
It's not a tumor.
I fucking love that movie. Though there's no discomfort at the moment, this tumor will unquestionably kill you in 6 months. However, your life can and will be saved by an operation. The only downside is that there will be a brutal incision to your frontal lobe. After the surgery, you'll be significantly less intelligent. You will still be a fully functioning adult, but you will be less logical, you will have a terrible memory, and you will have little ability to understand complex concepts or difficult ideas. The surgery is in 2 weeks. How do you spend the next 14 days?
Well, we're going to smoke a lot of weed, like, for sure. That would be one of them. I guess what would suck is, like, all these memories that I would create in those, like, 2 weeks, I'd forget about them anyways. Like, after this operation, if the memory is really bad. But
I feel like I wouldn't smoke weed. Like, this is coming from someone who I haven't missed a day since I was, like, 16. And I'm 33 now, so y'all do the math out there, because I can't. But I think for that 2 weeks, I'd be like, I know that my dumbass is going to smoke a shit ton of weed. It's going to be one of the only things I'm still doing after this operation. So I think I need to be clear-headed for this 2 weeks for once.
Yeah, it would be a lot of traveling for me, maybe going and, you know, I mean, we're just assuming hypothetical, right? So I have access to a private jet that I could go anywhere that I want to go, you know, so we would definitely hit up whatever the biggest sporting events were. I'm assuming, you know, there's an unlimited amount of money in this hypothetical question. So we're hitting up like every major sporting event that's like happening around the country, potentially the world, depending on what kind of things are going on overseas. And seeing some landmarks that, you know, visiting some countries that I would probably never visit, like, because of all this.
You're definitely blowing it out. It's funny because it's like, I don't even know if I would, like, want to, like, the idea of that is like, yeah, but then it's like, even on a private jet, like, how much time are you just, like, sitting in the plane, like, let's fucking get there already?
In this hypothetical, you know, thing, we could smoke weed on the plane is what I'm saying. Yeah. And so we'd be doing that on the plane, I'm sure.
All right. Well, I mean, like with the whole creative process, like how do you go from turning ideas of like, you know, you're just like, oh, fucking idea of content. How do you go? What's your process of taking that into turning it into actionable content?
So a lot of my content, like I'm legit a man of the people, like everything that I started with content wise was question and answers. That was like the biggest thing that I was doing right off the bat, because like, why do people go search for people on YouTube or people potentially live streaming? A lot of times it's because they have a question and they want to get it answered. So I wouldn't be like a dick who like wouldn't, you know, I'd pick and choose. Like I would legit go down every single comment, you know, and people respected it even if they had to wait. And so that was one of like the big things. And then I guess I just kind of started seeing what everybody else was doing and how like there's a weekly flow to fantasy content where it's just things that we do in like normal life, you know, with fantasy. You know, we got our waiver days. We got the you know, we got the Thursday game, so we got to make some start sit decisions. You know, we're going to have injury news throughout the week. And so we started doing a daily well, at least a Monday through Friday news show as well. And the time that we picked, it's 1 o'clock West Coast time, 4 o'clock Eastern time. We picked that time because during the season, that is like the biggest hour where the most news is actually coming out. Like there's a bunch that comes out before that. There's a bunch that comes after that. But that like specific hour, we're getting so much breaking news that people are like on the show. And we're like, all right, this is not a drill. Go pick up this person because this person just got hurt, you know, and we're like, literally helping people like make these decisions before their league is even hip to what's going on.
No, and I respect, I mean, you live up to the hustler name and I respect the grind because I'm like the complete opposite. I have set this show up to do the fucking total reverse of everything you just said. Man of the people, my ass. Fuck the people. No, I love the people. But I just, I'm like, I can't, I don't do live streams. I don't do any of that shit. All my shit, even my normal regular shows are pre-recorded. I only do two a week. This one counts as a third. And this is by far my favorite one. Like, honestly, I almost feel like the fantasy content I'm doing is just like an excuse to be able to do this show. So it's like, I'm like the complete opposite. So I super respect. And it's funny, I'm going to reveal myself here. I actually follow you on a couple accounts. Obviously, like I use my Fantasy Joker one so that people see that visible brand. But yeah, more often than not, and you're often like pulling up my comments and you're like, who's this fucking dumbass guy? That dumbass is me. That's like my regular YouTube. It's funny because like, so I got a kid, my daughter, she's 10. My stepson, he's 13. But my daughter, like she's not allowed social media. So all her shit's like through mine.
Yeah.
So I have like my normal, like my old normal YouTube, and I had to set up the burner. And then I have like the third one now. It's a fucking pain in the ass. I hate. That was the other thing too, is like I had to set everything up like in my own name, just because like I literally couldn't handle the grind that you're on. So like, what cup? Like it's kind of a two-part question, but it's like, what's the in? Like, what is the inspiration? I mean, obviously, besides the aspect of like I got to get paid and I got to make a living, but like, What's the inspiration? What gets you on that grind? And then more than that, what gets you through the negative days? And when I don't even mean like outward negativity. I'm talking more like the inward, like, fuck, I just don't feel like doing this shit right now. So like, what gets you through that?
Well, and legit, I mean, I've always been a hustler. Like, I mean, I come, my family, four kids, you know, I'm the oldest of it. And it just seemed like there was a certain time where it was like, you better go get a job if you want to get the shit that you want, you know, in life. Like, I mean, my parents, it's not like they didn't provide for me. They provided everything that they needed to, you know, but like any kind of extra, I just always needed to do something to get it myself. So I feel like creating this big ass community, like I'm a real community based person. And so like, even though a lot of people, I mean, everyone in the community knows I'm doing this to make money. You're like, you're signing up on a membership, you know, to like support my dream in this business and everything. But I like legit pride myself on like creating an experience for people that I wish that someone would create for me. Cause I'm like a degenerate fantasy football, like diehard.
No, and I do think that you represent an important aspect of counterculture that isn't always present in fantasy football. And it's like you take even a big show like Fantasy Footballers, which I love those guys. Like they fucking even, and it's funny because like even more than Footballers, I love their just regular show Spitballers, which is a little bit kind of like, you know, this show is a little bit an homage to more that than like the regular fantasy football shit.
Yeah.
But it's like that aspect of counterculture is even missing from that show because it's like, you know, to a degree, it's like they're not going to talk about certain topics, obviously, that are offhand. You know, they're not going to smoke weed and like talk about that. It's funny because like weed for me is like such a normal thing that I almost like,
because you're in Canada,
I don't think like, to even talk about like, oh, I'm 420 friendly. It's like, no, I'm fucking Canadian.
I'm from California. And so, you know, it's a culture in California. And so like, but literally everybody outside of California that I'm meeting, you know, it's so taboo. Like we have a big following in Minnesota. And Minnesota just went recreationally legal, you know, this year. I mean, it's been at least legal in California since like 1996, as far as like medical, you know, they didn't have any medical or anything. So this is like the first time that they're even like, you know, they're so happy because now like they can smoke weed without like getting in trouble or anything. And yeah, it's just normal for Californians for sure. Like they even call it California sober. I don't know if you've heard that term. Like after people say they stop drinking. Oh yeah, we're in California sober, which means you just partake in the greenery.
No, I have this really, so like when I was young, so this is in part a story, but also a question. And you kind of touched on it earlier with what you had mentioned with your college experience. So when I was young and I was really heavy into my writing days, I was on this site and it was like a community-based writing site. And I met this dude from California and it was really kind of random. We just kind of hit up like a friendship. He was an older dude, but he grew weed. I was like, okay, cool. And then he like sent me a story and asked me to edit it for him. And I did. I was just like, I didn't expect anything of it. I just was like, yeah, no problem, dude. Did it up, sent it back to him. Couple weeks later, and he had said like, I'm just going to send you like a little like care package to say thank you if that's okay. And I was like, I didn't catch on right away what he meant. And like a couple weeks later, I get a fucking, he must have sent me like a quarter pound of just like California Kush. I swear the buds were like straight off the top of the stock. He just walked out, fucking snipped them off. Where I was like, this is the dopest fucking man in the world. So Bill from California, if you're out there somewhere, shout out to you, my man.
That's awesome.
The whole lead up to that is like, so I kind of do have some hidden talents, even though I am like the Joker and I like fucking and kind of falling ass backwards into this whole thing. Like I'm a writer. That's like a thing since I was a kid. Also, I went to college for marketing and SEO, so that definitely helps me. So you had already mentioned the video editing stuff. What are some more of those like hidden talents and some of maybe those skills that you were able to develop that really help you with the content creation?
It's marketing and sales, and not a lot of it came from, especially like none of the sales came from like school, like some marketing, you know, did back in the junior college days, back in the day. But I don't know what it is about sales, but that's something that's always kind of been fun to me. And this can even go back to when I'm like 9 years old and I'm selling like chips and Capri Sun to people at school whose parents won't like give it to them, but they give them money for sure. And then like in junior high, I'm the one who has like a backpack full of candy, selling you candy before school and during lunch and everything. So I just feel like there's a lot of services that need to be filled, you know, and like, I guess I just find a way to be that guy to provide a lot of services for people. It's just fun.
It reminds me of my buddy. He used to sell, I mean, besides the fact that he sold out of a fanny pack, which was like the funniest fucking thing ever. But like way back in like my very youth days, like back when weed was illegal in Canada, he used to sell, he was the only one that sold two chunks. Fucking, this guy's out here selling point twos for $2 to like teenagers that don't have any more than like their fucking milk money for school.
And
they're just like putting it in one hitters and just like hitting it up. And I asked him one day, like, why the fuck are you selling two chunks? Like, it's just such a waste of time. And I just straight face looked me in the eye and he goes, because Jack, some kids only have $2 and I still want it.
Yeah, for sure. And like whatever profit margin he would make on a $10 sale, I'm sure it was like quadruple that for a $2 sale. He's way smaller, but a lot more profit.
Yeah. So, I mean, hey, we'll skip right into another hypothetical here. Nice, you know, light, easy, breezy one again. Don't want to get too dark and heavy. You're in a plane crash in the Andes Mountains. Not unlike those people from the movie Alive. As such, you will be forced to consume the human flesh of the people who died on impact. This will be a terrible experience, but it is the only way for you to survive. Fortunately, you did not know any of the victims personally. Would you rather eat a dead baby, or would you rather eat a dead elderly person? Would gender play a role in the selection process? And how much would it bother you if this meat turned out to be delicious?
I just wouldn't do it. Like, that's just what it is. Like, we would just find a way. We, through hell or high water, we would find a way to not do this somehow. I can't go cannibal.
It's just you. You're alone in this situation. Somehow you're alone. You're able to make fire. You're on the top, tippy top of this mountain. There's nothing else. There's fuck all. You're on day 4 or 5 to where like you're getting delirious hungry and you're like, meat is meat.
I don't think I would. I think I would die on that hill.
Like, I'm not gonna lie, I wouldn't even make it to like day 3. I'd be like, if everybody else is dead, I didn't know any of them.
And I would
probably, my guy.
I would probably be one of those people. It'd be someone else making a decision on do they want to eat me because I'm a little bit bigger. You know, like, man, if it's not glamping, like, I don't know if I'm going to be doing it outside.
My thing is, I'm definitely looking. It's funny it mentions baby and elderly. And I'm like, no. I'm looking for a middle-aged porker. I'm looking for the fat. I don't care the gender, the race. I'm just looking for who's about 40-ish looking and the plumpest. And that's my first choice. They're going to sustain me for hopefully it's just that one person. And then the thing is like, so, you know, it's funny is that's like a thing that like, apparently if you do succumb to cannibalism, like you develop a taste for it. Even if it was like in an emergency survival situation as the one we are describing, it's like, if I were to do that and then survive, would I then like turn into fucking Hannibal Lecter where I'm like inviting people over and I'm like with my nice little Chianti?
Go search up Los Angeles cannibal restaurant and like it will blow your mind. There is a restaurant in there. Like, they legit bring people in for like sacrifices and stuff. So like just literally, well, that's all I'm going to say about that. But anyone who's listening, you want to like have your mind blown by some shit like that, just search up Los Angeles cannibal restaurant. And like, it's crazy because it's the elite of the elite that go there.
Oh my God.
It's insane.
So,
it's insane.
I mean, we had kind of touched like on the negative stuff inwardly and like dealing with that. Like obviously, when you represent counterculture, you're inviting, in a sense, negative feedback.
That's for sure.
How do you take that in and deal with that? I think with you know, it's funny because it's like I feel like there's like a last generation, a last bastion. There's like a cutoff of people that like understood what real tough love was supposed to be. Let me drop a little clip for you right here. Shout out to check out Shorzy on Hulu. It's the same dude that makes Letterkenny.
Fucking bullying. Everybody's so soft. It's tough love.
What's the difference?
All right, we're teammates. We're brothers.
Yeah.
I'd go to the wall for you.
Yeah.
Are you my brother?
You're my brother.
Would you go to the wall for me?
I'll go to the wall.
Then you're allowed to call me a fucking useless cunt on your way there.
Yeah.
Hell yeah. Fuck yeah.
Well, and so I guess like I'm 37, so I was born in 1986, and like all like I graduated in 2004. So like, you know, as far as like anyone caring about anyone's feelings, like that was non-existent for like most of my life. And like it's tough to say, but yeah, like nobody I come from a time where I know that nobody cares about like my feelings. Nobody cares if I do good or bad, you know, and people do. I don't mean it like that. Like people who are close to me do, but literally like in the grand scheme of the world, the universe, you know, like nobody really cares how good or bad I do. So one thing that I will say is dealing with the negative stuff. This is going into season four for me. I don't think I've really been able to handle it until right now, to where I don't like kind of clap back a little bit, to where I like have to talk a little bit of shit, kind of get the last word. But now I feel like just realizing that, you know, we're going to have, and I already knew this, but we're going to have haters. Haters are going to be there anyways. You know, I have I think you are in that group on Facebook where it's like 92, like 1,000 people, you know, or whatever. And like, now, like, instead of like responding, I just like mute people for a couple days if they're going to be douchebags. And yeah, if you're going to watch me, you can watch me. But now you can't say anything, you know, for a couple days until you get out of timeout, you know. And that's kind of how I've been handling it. Like, literally, there's no matter what we do, there's going to be haters. And like, I'm just trying to put zero energy into those people and put 100% of my energy into the people that are like supporting this mission and vibing with us.
For sure. I mean, I've only been doing this for like a very short period of time, and like a handful of months. I tried doing it once before, and it was kind of a situation where it's like it blew up with me and the person I was doing it with. And so for a long time, I was put off of it. And then that's why I've set it up now to where it's like, at the end of the day, everything's just like all on me and in my name. And then I do a lot of affiliate stuff.
Yeah.
And it's like I was able to like kind of insulate myself that way this time. You know,
that is the best. Like
I'm gonna say, like, is that basically like what you've been able to do for yourself, I guess, is my question.
Yeah. I've had a lot of people try to approach me to like, you know, jump on their brands and stuff like that. And like I grew in 2020, week one of the NFL season, I had like maybe like 30 or 40 followers on YouTube. By week 12, I was like fully monetized like on YouTube. Like it was just the crazy COVID growth, you know, was there. And like there's a lot of people who couldn't do it, but it's because like being a man of the people, like I'm providing what people want. Like I'm not just putting out content that I think is cool. Like I'm like there, like specifically answering questions that people want to get, that just, you know, that immediate like response, you know, that like they feel like that's what people want like these days. I feel like this is like live streaming is like the future of like, you know, just TV or however you consume, you know, just anything, any kind of media.
So, I mean, what kind of medias are you using? You're like all over the place right now. Can you like recap a little bit for us? Just like where we're able to find you in total. Usually I do this at like the end of the show, but like yours, I feel like, is a bigger web. So I kind of want to get it more like in the meat of it.
Yeah. So YouTube and almost everything is at FFHustler420. I tried to keep it uniform like that. So we're live streaming every time we go live. We're on YouTube. We're on Twitter. We're on Twitch. And Twitch is the 420 Fantasy Hustler Network. Over there, but I think you can search Fantasy Football Hustler or 420 Hustler and it'll pop up. And then we're always streaming into like six or seven different destinations on Facebook. So like on my personal Facebook page where I maybe have like 2,000 or 3,000 followers, like we're there. I have a dynasty advice group, and there's like 3,000 people there. And then the group that I created a long time ago, if you search fantasy football, it's like the top group in Facebook. It's Fantasy Football Advice for Experts, Gurus, and Beginners. I started it 8 years ago, and we just crossed 92,000 members.
Nice.
Huge.
So, and I mean, you've been able to accomplish some pretty cool shit. I wanted to talk about one specific thing that was really dope. Obviously, you had Ricky Williams on, and that's like a recurring thing. Yeah. How did that come about? You know, how'd you put that together? Because that's fucking obviously like a huge get.
So it's the universe. Like the universe works in mysterious ways. And like the way that this happened is so insane because This is COVID, and it's I'm answering questions. I'm ripping my bong as I've been doing now this whole show. And someone comes in the chat and he asks a question. I answer, and he was like, "Hey," and ripping the bong. He was like, "I knew I was in the right place." And this person ends up being like, he's one of the top venture capitalists in the cannabis like industry. I don't know this at the time, you know, but we've known each other for almost 4 years at this point. And so, like, I was sick one time, and he's like, "Man, I got some cool stuff that I'm going to send you." He's like, "You can't be ripping the bong when you're, like, dying, you know, over here coughing." He's like, "I'm going to send you some dab stuff, you know, and get some low-temp dabs going, you know," and sends me one item is maybe, like, a $200 item. It's, like, a butter machine. And, like, the other one is, like, this $300, like, travel dab rig. Like type thing. I'm like, "Man, okay, so I guess this guy is the real deal." And then we don't talk or anything for a little while, and he comes back when the season's going on, and he's like, "Man," he was like, "you know, I work with like a bunch of cannabis brands and CBD brands." He's like, "One day I'm gonna get like a real dope, you know, like we're gonna get someone real dope to like come on your show." And first he said like Rob Gronkowski, and like at this point I don't really know him, you know, like that. And I'm like, yeah, sure, you know, I don't say that, but that's what I'm thinking. I'll believe it when I see it, you know, type thing. And our bond, you know, grows as we like we know each other longer. We're in leagues, you know. Then we have like we got each other's number through email and all that, so we're actually becoming friends. And then he gets linked up with Heisman, which is Ricky Williams' brand. And they're, I mean, not at this point, but at least at the point of when this happened, they were a newer brand. It just started. And, you know, the whole thing of what we're doing is weed and football, weed and fantasy football, weed and sports, you know, and that's like Ricky Williams shit, like weed and sports. Who's known better for weed and sports than Ricky Williams? And so we get the first interview like hooked up through his marketing people and everything. And he comes on, and it's fucking awesome. And it's like, I don't know, like October of 2021 or 22. I can't even remember which year it's been. It's been so long. And like at the end, he's like, "Man," he's like, "I really love this. This is a cool vibe. We got to smoke." He's like, "I'd love to come back on in the future." And it was, yes. And you know, it's like maybe like 6 months or so. And then he came on again, and then he came on again, and then after that next season, I was talking more to his marketing guy, and he was like, "We really want to get more involved, you know, this year. And so we really want to help push you guys more. And we know you like been pushing Heisman for a while." And so they pretty much said that Ricky would come on like, you know, give or take once a month. It's like not, he couldn't specifically commit to once a month because like contract with other podcasts that he has. But he's pretty much came on like once a month, like this entire year. And like it's dope. He just comes on for the smoke session. Like, I mean, we ask him some of the cliche stuff now, but it's like he went on the Pat McAfee show a week ago or something. And like McAfee, he's already said, like, who'd be the coolest guy to smoke with? Like, Ricky Williams. Like, I've actually smoked with Ricky Williams multiple times, like, in person now. He actually, like, came over to my house, and it's one of my wife's claim to fame. She's like, I told Ricky Williams to go around the side of the house. And just, like, so funny. And, like, we were smoking weed, and he was, he's an astrologist, where he reads, like, you know, the charts and all that, and it's crazy how a lot of that kind of plays into football and fantasy football. And we've done a little bit of deep diving as far as like how it correlates a little bit. And one day there will be like a big project that we're going to be on. It's like, it's finding, you know, how we're going to do it and the angles we're going to take.
You know, it's a good segue because I usually ask this question. It's one of my favorite questions to ask. And obviously, with you being the fantasy football hustler, that's like a moniker that is very represented by your personality. What are maybe some other personality traits and values that actually bleed into your fantasy football playing style? So like how you manage your teams and then how you play the game.
So loyalty to a fault is, you know, it's a blessing and a curse. But also one thing that a lot of times is like knowing when to cut things loose, you know, like knowing when to hold them or when to fold them, you know, type thing. And I feel like in business and in life, I feel like if there's certain things that need to happen, if there's certain things that need to get cut off or like whatever, not physically cut off, but you know what I mean? Like, I'm not the type of guy who's going to beat around the bush and say, dang, maybe I better wait to do this. Like, I react on instinct, and sometimes it hurts me. But more often than not, it really helps, especially with like waiver wire, getting rid of guys, you know, versus holding on to them for a couple weeks. And trends, that's another thing that I've always been really good at, is trends.
Well, and I think, you know, in life, like, and in fantasy football, so like in relationships especially, it's very easy to get a sunk cost fallacy, where it's like, I've invested X, and so I must do Y. Like, I invested draft pick so high. I invested so much time in this relationship. And now I must keep this player to a fault. I must continue in this shit no matter what kind of deal. I think that's like an easy illusion to fall into. And definitely something to be aware of just in general in both situations.
That's for sure.
So we'll dip into another hypothetical for you. This is actually legitimately probably like, even though technically it's still like kind of about murder, this is somehow lighter than the last two. You are a hired assassin. It was not your lifelong dream to become a hitman, but that's the vacation destiny has forced upon you. Killing these strangers bothers you deeply. Very often, you are haunted by vivid dreams involving your victims. But you've also become somewhat accustomed to the experience. You have successfully murdered 10 people over the past 2 years. Your fee is $100,000 per murder. Knowing your reputation for ruthless efficiency, a member of the criminal underworld asks you to murder his enemy, who is also a known criminal. I really hate this guy, he says, the prospective employer. He has done terrible things to someone I love, so I want you to kill him. But I don't want you to simply kill him. I want you to make him pay. I want you to kill him in the most vicious, sinister way you can imagine. Be creative and merciless. And if you do this, I will pay you 25 times your normal fee. So he's giving you $2.5 million for this job to make it real juice. Assuming you're already a professional killer who lives outside of society's rules, would you accept these new conditions? And if so, how would you commit the murder? So you're John Wick, basically, in this situation.
I've already thought about it. I would tie the cement boots. Like, we'd have to do it mafia style. They would get the cement boots, and then I would be throwing them in, and it would be quick and easy, I guess. You know, as quick and easy, I guess, as it is for me. And because they say like drowning is one of the worst, like it's like either drowning or being burned alive, they say, is kind of like the worst ways that you could die.
Would you rather pick between those two?
Well, I mean, it if it was me doing it, I'm just putting the cement boots on because then I can walk away and they're going down to the bottom of the ocean and then I'm out of there. If it's somewhere else where I have to like watch it happen, that's where it starts getting a little bit tricky.
There's no situation I'm taking the burning. I'll drown 100 times out of 100 before a 5-minute burn.
Yeah.
Give me a 30-minute drown over a fucking 30-second burn even.
Yeah.
Yo, you ever just burn your hand on the stove? Fuck that. No.
I couldn't.
But you kind of, I mean, you incidentally hit on it. I don't know. This is kind of like a random question, but like, do you know a lot about like Las Vegas mafia history? Because I know there's like a lot of ties. And it's like kind of almost goes under the radar because I think people are always like New York, Chicago, those are like the big ones. But like Las Vegas, and it's funny because it's like I kind of know this because of dumb shows like Bar Rescue and Hell's Kitchen, where they go to like these restaurants that used to be like mafia places. Yeah. Like how much of that culture like are you aware of? Is that something you're into?
Well, I went to the Mob Museum that's here, okay. And I mean, it was only like $30, and it's at the old school like courthouse, and it's kind of like right in downtown by Fremont Street. It's super interesting. I mean, I'm all about the gangster movies and, you know, the mafia movies and the Goodfellas and the casinos and all that. And I feel like just casino in general is a real good look at how like the mafia like used to run it. I will tell you though, Vegas, I'm sure was way better when the mafia ran it. It wasn't a family town, you know, like it is now. But I'll tell you, one of the things that's crazy is like the Lake Mead. That's like kind of like by the Hoover Dam and all that. Like just this past year, they pulled bodies out of there. They said were probably, you know, from the 70s when, you know, when the mafia was more prevalent than ever in Vegas.
Random question too. The mole people in Vegas, that's a thing, isn't it? Like they live in underground in the sewers.
So I only know that from the legends, you know, because I've never tried to like go see if this is like true, but that's what I've heard. Like, man, I mean, you can just go search on TikTok like Las Vegas like underground or like, you know, homeless underground, and it's like apparently this whole huge like homeless culture like underneath like bridges and, you know, in the water runoffs or whatever. So like when it rains, apparently they all come out. But the legend is, it's like the farther in you are, like that's like your status like amongst the community. So like the guy who's like all the way in the back, like he's like the leader.
Yeah, he's the rat king. Yeah, it's funny because it's like this is all like random to me. It's almost like mythological where you live, because it's like, again, it's like I live up in Canada under a frozen rock, and it's like when I say I live in Canada, people don't fully take in, because it's like I don't just live in Canada, I live in Quebec, and I don't just live in Quebec, I live an hour north of Montreal. Like probably 60 to 70% of the people here don't speak English. And if they do, it's with a heavy accent. So it's like, it's so like just complete culture. You may as well be in fucking Europe here. Like it's not the same. So to me, places like Vegas and New York literally are almost like mythological, legendary places that don't actually exist. So that's why I'm just like peppering you with these weird, stupid questions of like random Vegas facts that have filled my head for years.
And I've only lived in Vegas for a year and a handful of months. So March of last year or April of last year is when we moved. I was in San Diego before that my whole life. Next year, because this is going to be a yearly tradition in Vegas, got to get out to Vegas next year. It'll be awesome. Everyone, there's multiple people who are like so like the – they feel like they missed out so much. They're like legit already like planning like the next year ahead, you know, now.
So the one thing I wanted to ask is like Vegas. Because I had seen recently you were doing like the video where you went to like the weed store there.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what is that? Like, what's that like basically? Can you elaborate a little bit on, I guess like the content of that video and like what you're doing with that?
So I always feel like I think of myself as a connoisseur, you know, to where I'm always on a hunt for like some of the best weed that I can find. A lot of times price isn't an issue, but I mean, I smoke a lot. So, I mean, I have to, it has to somewhat fit in my budget. I'm not a millionaire yet, yeah. You know? And so I would never go to it's pretty much like the biggest tourist spot, Planet 13. And it's like world's biggest dispensary. And like, it's not just the dispensary. I mean, they have like, you know, a whole food court in there. Like they're going to open up a consumption lounge with like a pool and like all this shit, you know, over the next like couple years. And they actually have like really good deals for locals. Like it's crazy because like their top weed, which I'm smoking some of it right now. I'm smoking on the Mike Tyson 2.0. Okay, nice. OG. And it's $75 an eighth if you're coming in, you know, just as a tourist. But
holy fuck.
When
oh my god. Bro, when I tell you how much I pay, you're gonna cry a little bit.
Well, no, this is over exaggerated for sure. Cause then so now with the local deal, it ends up being like, you know, around 140, like after tax. It's like 115 or 120, but the crazy ass tax, you know, takes it up to that. So you're paying that either way, but still not too bad for like really compared to there's $50 half ounce stuff here and $60, $70 ounce stuff. But like, okay. My palate is a lot, like I don't drink, I can't, it's the equivalent of drinking, you know, some 40-ounce Mickey's or some Steel Reserve, you know, or some shit like that. And, like, my palate is just, you know, like, if we're talking about beer, which I don't really drink beer, but for people who may understand that a little bit more in the weed, it's like getting one of the super fine IPAs, you know, or something where you're going to pay a lot more, you know, for what you can get a 30-pack for, you're getting a 4-pack for, you know, like, that shit.
So, like, I'm the same way, but it's like, oh man, I don't know if I could fucking, I'd have to like reduce by a lot how much I smoke. Cause like I basically get the top shelf. Like, so I'm smoking right now. This is some Ice Wreck Kush.
Okay.
And then the other stuff I got was Gary Payton.
Yeah.
And then, like, I've had Mike Tyson a couple times. Like all that, like, and it's like 4A plus. Like the craft, like cup kind of fucking winning shit. Literally, so like the last order I just made was $150 for, I got an ounce and a half. So this was an ounce and then another half ounce. And then just for shits and giggles, they just throw in a fucking eighth and some free keef as like a gift. Cause I keep ordering from the same place. And it's like, dude, that's Canadian money. In your money, that's like $100.
Yeah, for sure. Right.
So it's like, it's fucking dirt cheap here. And that's like the top shelf premium. I can get fucking the low grade stuff for like fucking, they're giving that shit away practically.
And it's the supply and demand in Vegas of what messes it up. Because like a demand for super high quality, you know, tree, like there's really not. If I'm in San Diego or if I'm in somewhere in California, the prices would be way better and there'd be way more abundance of like the top quality. What sucks here is there's not an abundance of like the high quality like stuff. And but luckily, you know, through just meeting people and networking, ever since I've been here in Vegas, I got introduced to Redwood Cultivation, and they're one. Really, I mean, I feel like they're the best cultivator in Vegas, or at least in Nevada. I mean, from all these ones that I've tried, and they do the stuff for cookies. They do Tyson 2.0. They do Willie Nelson Reserve, and they do the Cheech and Chong. Nice.
All right, we'll get into one last hypothetical here. It's weird that we kind of touched on it. You now have to go down into those dirty tunnels. You encounter, we'll say it's the tunnels. You go down into the dirty tunnels with the homeless people, human waste, dried blood. There's at least 50 people lying in there, men, women, and teenagers. It's like the middle of summer. None of them have bathed in weeks. Fewer crackheads. Most are intoxicated. Handful are mentally insane. All of them are hungry and desperate. Suddenly, You are granted an incredible capability. If you have unprotected intercourse with any one of these individuals, right then and there, immediately on the side, or I guess on the tunnel floor, in public, you will end worldwide homelessness forever. Within 5 years, no one will ever be homeless again. And everyone in the world will know it was because of you and your selfless act. You're a hero now.
I feel like I would have to, like, if I could really do that, I would probably have to bite the bullet. I don't know how I would do it. Like, the act of it, like, it's still making me sick thinking about it. I'm, like, trying to smoke to, like, figure out how. I would figure out, you know, we're going to pimp that into, like, billions of dollars somehow, you know. Like, this is going to have to create, you know, somehow of generational upon generational wealth for, like, my family somehow. And like,
oh, yeah, I mean, you saved the world. You're literally like, you go from, it's like you do the basically the grossest, it's like, are you willing to do the grossest thing possible to then come through the other side of it? This is basically Shawshank Redemption. Are you willing to climb through your 500 feet of pure prison shit to get to your freedom on the other side? Are you willing to fuck the grossest, most dirtiest fucking homeless stranger to end world homelessness forever and thereby the next day basically become the most, not just like famous, you would be revered. You're like Nelson Mandela level of like, this man is Mother Teresa for fucking this homeless person.
Like, and
the other caveat too is you get to pick. So like, out of all these like grodies, you at least do get to like,
it would be whichever one's closer, whichever one I don't have to go farther in to get, like, at that point, right?
Oh dude, I honestly I'm going all the way to the back to the Rat King. I gotta see every single one of these fuckers so that I can choose like the lesser of the evils.
And I'm assuming in this hypothetical that I wouldn't die by doing this, you know, somehow. So
no, I mean, even it, like, what's the worst that's going to happen? You're going to contract AIDS, and now you're as rich as Magic Johnson, so you'll live with it.
Yeah, for sure. When you're rich, you can get the right concoction.
Yeah. The concoction, according to South Park, is just an injection of straight money to the veins.
Yeah, for sure. We should have enough by then to where we could just inject it.
All right. So, I mean, now that we've saved the whole fucking world, we'll just wrap up this little podcast here, or this little show, because I never do just audio. I'm too lazy to fucking rip the audio and put it in places that I should. Shout-outs. Shout-out some content creators that you just enjoy what they're doing in the space. Or especially, like, for a goof like me, I always say surround yourself with people smarter than you. So, like, some of the accounts you rely on to, like, either help you drive, like, some of your content, or especially, like, that you just rely on for advice. Because I think, like, you know, it's like, who do the content creators, like, still listen to and rely on for advice? That's always like a good question.
Yeah, so we'll shout out to my co-host Bogart Scott Free. He does with the GMM Network, and we do, I mean, all pretty much all the content together. So I mean, really, it's a lot of just me and him sharpening each other and staying on the news, you know. Shout out to him, shout out to the 420 crew. Like, they're the guys who are like in all of our, you know, chats and live streams and all that. Really, as far as like content creators go, like, I mean, shout out to everybody who's like supporting the mission that I'm on. You know, like, we got like guys like Bandy from Fourth and Flex. We got Chris from Patriot Sports Radio. We got Disco from Big Draft Energy. He's in Canada as well. And these are guys who, they met me because of the group. One of the services that I offer to content creators is you can pay a small amount of money per month to advertise in this group with 90 plus thousand people. And it's only $15 to $30 a month. It kind of depends on like what you want. And like, a lot of these guys, you know, they want to do this full time, And, you know, they didn't really think twice, you know, and they understand that this is a part of like the business and, you know, supporting what I got going on. And I'm driving a good ship here. We're building stuff. And I just want everybody to eat a little bit. But I do want people to remember, like, people are going to do things. Sometimes you got to pay a little bit to be a part of the crew, you know, because a lot of work goes into a lot of things.
That's awesome. So, man, I super fucking appreciate you taking the time to be on the show. Shout out to all the listeners out there. Go fucking follow at FFHustler420 everywhere that you can find him. He's, if I was on the reverse side and I had been shouting out people, he would have been one of the people I was shouting out. It's exactly why I had to have him on the fucking show. So thank you to all you listeners out there. And as always, catch you on the flip side.
He's out.
He's running down the middle by the 50. He's at the 30. He's bare-chested and banging his chest. Now he runs the opposite way. He runs at the 50. He runs at the 40. The guy is drunk, but there he goes. The 20. They're chasing him. They're not going to get him. Waving his arms, bare-chested. Somebody stop
that
man.
Look out. Here comes-